All I can say is the traveling MSI fans are the best fucking people you'll ever meet.
No, I feel like I got pregnant just from watching it, man! Damn!
Seeing MSI is like having sex with a random girl, corpse, or animal. Did I read that good?
Good, I got my carrot signed by all of them.
This has been a shitty video film brought to you by Mindless Self-Indulgence. Thank you very much, have a good night. I got everything signed. Fuck.
Mindless Self-Indulgence is a name that will elicit one of two responses out of those who hear it. Pure disgust or undying admiration. Polarizing by design, from the sound to the lyrics to the vulgarity to even the imagery, Mindless Self-Indulgence is a band that thrives off of chaos and revels in mean-spirited satire and cynical social critique. A band that has been one of my all-time favorites since middle school, and a band who, in my opinion, deserves much more love and respect than they've ever seen. MSI began life in the mid-90s as a solo project of singer Jimmy Urin. Jimmy being the main songwriter and driving force behind the band throughout its entire run. The original iteration of Mindless Self-Indulgence only performed a few shows and released a single self-titled EP. This early iteration of the band had a far more serious tone as to what would follow, with a sound resembling a fusion between the sounds of new wave and industrial music. With songs giving obvious nods to both Nine Inch Nails and Susie and the Banshees. It wasn't until 1998, after Jimmy recorded a cover of the song Bring the Pain by Wu-Tang legend Method Man, that he would reevaluate MSI and form a four-piece band. And from this, it would lead to the debut album from MSI, Tight. Tight was the debut from the Mindless Self-Indulgence that we know today, a short, abrasive album taking the industrial new wave sounds that Jimmy started off with and fusing them with punk, hip-hop, and jungle music. The lyrical content also took a massive departure from the serious and depressive lyrics of the self-titled EP, and became cartoonishly obnoxious, humorous, and outright juvenile. Though it's in these juvenile lyrics that we see the beginning of Jimmy's cynical worldview pop out. Not to the extent of what is to come, but enough to show promise. A majority of the songs on Tight center around sex-based humor, gangster rap references, and most importantly, self-deprecation. Even on the opening song of the album, Grab the Mic, the lyrics, "Everything old is new, again and again and again and again." Something that I can't help but feel is a nod at how much this album bites 90s gangster rap, when the song that follows is the band's infamous cover of Bring the Pain. The only other song off Tight that boldly shows this growing cynicism to music and its fans is Bite Your Rhymes, a song where Jimmy takes shots at other artists and deprecates himself at the same time.
Bring on down. Now you creative motherfuckers, making all them original masterpieces of shit. Y'all be slipping.
While Tight as an album didn't do amazing, it did help them score a cult following, and with the band's first real tour being an opening slot for Korn, it helped to grow MSI's notoriety, and with this newfound attention, they would only grow much larger with the release of their second album, Frankenstein Girls.
Self-indulgence, and we just woke the fuck up!
Frankenstein Girls will seem strangely sexy, or simply Frankenstein Girls as the fans would come to know it, was the second full-length Mindless Self-Indulgence record. And the album has a storied history of being a massive jolt and failure for the band's career, With the growing notoriety the band saw after their first record and tour with Korn, many major labels were trying to sign MSI as they saw them and their sound as the next big thing, especially since the album was also being pushed for a spring 2000 release. And with the Y2K era seeing a lot of bands such as the Chemical Brothers, Linkin Park, Static X, and even Orgy selling platinum records crossing the same genres that MSI was, it was no surprise that labels wanted a piece of that pie, though they would be disappointed with the reaction that would actually come from the foul album Jimmy had brewing.
I love my mommy cause she fucked my dad. I love my mommy cause she fucked the shit out of my dad. I love my mommy cause she...
The band would intentionally ruin their mixes at the end of every session, all in an attempt to waste the money that was being funneled to them by various labels, while also writing the songs to be as short and uncommercial as they could since the label wanted an album that was radio-friendly. This led the band to write even more juvenile and offensive songs than what you would hear on Tight. Despite everything though, Elektra was the label that had been able to sign Mindless and even helped them procure an album art by Jamie Hewitt, who was also supposed to do a music video for the band but later cancelled due to him starting Gorillaz with Damon Albarn. If this all sounds like a recipe for disaster, then don't worry, it gets much worse. Frankenstein Girls was one of those albums that came out right at the beginning of the Napster reign of terror on the music industry.
You know what, maybe I wouldn't have to whore myself out if you f***ing kids didn't steal my music.
We're not stealing, okay? We're just sharing with each other, you know?
So it's like if I take this soda can right here, take a sip out of it.
Oh my God, I'm sharing my soda with Lars Ulrich.
And you know what? I'm just sharing 10 years of groupies with you, frat boy. I'm starting to like this whole sharing thing. Hey, boys!
Hey, Bobby! Some crazy roadies just stole my car!
Not the Pinto!
Napster. Sharing's only fun when it's not your stuff.
And with Elektra pricing the album at $30 and limiting its release, this basically encouraged piracy. And so the album soon began to make its rounds on Napster, mostly attracting a younger fan base of high schoolers and college kids, making the album both a financial failure and a massive step forward for the band, as even though they made almost no money from it, the band's shows started to sell out around this time and their online presence grew exponentially. Frankenstein Girls is a 30-song monster of an album, with all the songs on it being anywhere from 1 to 2 minutes long. The album is a really must-listen experience, containing some of the band's most challenging and over-the-top material. It's also here that we really see Jimmy showing off more of his cynical thoughts, and taking potshots at society, the music industry, and even the listener themselves. Starting with the song Backmask, opening with Jimmy encouraging a crowd of people to chant that the band sucks. Only to be followed by lyrics satirizing the popular backmask conspiracy, where many believe satanic messages and songs could be heard if they played them backward, only for the backmask lyrics in the song itself to say things like, clean your room, eat your vegetables, and worst of all, do your homework. While the song's actual lyrics encourage the listener to commit suicide, the entire song mocks people for looking for satanic messages while ignoring the already toxic and negative lyrics many songs already contained. The rest of the album is a juvenile mess of absurd lyrics aimed at pissing off not only the listeners, but any music executive who realized that they spent money funding such an obnoxious and foul album littered with slurs, profanity, gay sex, and spite aimed at society itself. And while I would love to pick out individual lyrics, this album serves its satire and its sound more than it does its lyrical content, so I can't recommend sitting down and listening to it enough. The album can be summarized by two excerpts from the song Ready for Love, those being,
my whole sound sucks in stereo.
Ugh.
I'm a waiter, my bank.
Pretty harsh, huh? But from here, we reach album number 3. You would think that after years of trying to break out, low-paying tours, opportunities falling through, internet piracy, and being rejected and dropped from major record labels, most bands would just call it quits. But for Jimmy Urine and the rest of MSI, quitting was not an answer. And because of this, we got album number 3, You'll Rebel to Anything as Long as It's Not Challenging, the band's most bitter, jaded, and cynical record to date. And my personal favorite. You'll Rebel to Anything, as most fans know it, was the band's breakout record, and the first time charting on Billboard. It was also the band's first album to almost completely be full of commercial-length songs. The album starts out with what's become the band's most well-known song, Shut Me Up. A 2 minute and 50 second barrage of guitars and drum machines with Jimmy mocking and antagonizing the listener to try and shut him up. A perfect way to set the tone for the album and especially the following song, 1989, where Jimmy takes a stab at the music industry and how it produces and pushes hundreds of identical artists. All this backed up by a fast-paced synth-pop banger. The album chugs along to its third track, Straight to Video, a song spotlighting the temptations of entering the porn industry during times of hardship, this being one of the most serious topics the band has covered up to this point, something we really only got to see on You'll Rebel and its follow-up If. It's at this midsection of the album where we see a series of 4 songs that really encapsulate the bitter and cynical way Jimmy views his audience and himself, all starting with the infamous title track of the album, a blunt and brazen stab at Molgoth culture, the at the time growing popularity of self-mutilation for attention, and even a few jabs at the band's own fans. And it's after this extremely harsh song that we are followed with What Do They Know? Possibly being the most honest and emotional song ever written by the band, with lyrics that describe Jimmy feeling shame and guilt over his decisions, culminating in his suicidal and self-destructive tendencies. Something I like to speculate as to why he consistently sabotaged himself whenever success was in his reach. It's here that we reach the punk rock anthem, Stupid Motherfucker, a song all about mocking the listener for not understanding Jimmy's fast-paced vocal delivery. This song doesn't have the most profound lyrics, but the absolutely over-the-top and corrosive way that Jimmy sings the song exerts an energy of unfiltered spite and sarcasm that is just magical to listen to. Two Hookers and an 8-Ball is a song best described as a bait and switch. The title combined with the first line and sound of the song immediately makes you think you're getting a typical juvenile absurd MSI track, something that you would have heard on Tight or Frankenstein Girls, only for it to really be a track where Jimmy opens up about how stupid his lyrics are and how dumb the people who like them are, while also going into how he knows how dumb his music can be, but he does it because he gets some money and sex. And it's lines like this that really show the self-aware and honestly, at times genius nature of Jimmy's writing and the band themselves. The last two songs in the album just revisit old ground, with Prom being the most commercial sounding track on the record, and Bullshit being a great closing track with very similar sentiment behind the title track, You'll Rebel to Anything, where Jimmy mocks his audience, as well as their parents for buying this stupid record for them. closing the album off with some extreme vulgarity and Jimmy's trademark cynicism. The follow-up from Your Bell to Anything is the album If. If was this sellout album for Mindless Self-Indulgence, at least that's what many fans say. Jimmy had stated in an interview that the band's goal with If was to actually create what they considered a good album for their fans. After finally finding great success, they wanted to give back. And while some people might find If to be very tame for MSI's taste, honestly, it's a fantastic album and my second favorite of their discography. The album's sound is much less fast-paced and chaotic, this time having a heavier focus on melody, traditional song structure, and more elements of punk rock and new wave music. If shows off much more maturity even in its juvenile nature, with more social conscious satire such as the song Prescription, which details the common issue of entertainers relying on drug use to get them through their performances.
Well, I don't need nothing before the show. I don't need nothing, well that's not so. I need something before the show. Just a little something to make me go. Wow, whoa.
Another example of this would be the song Money, a song detailing just how much of a money-grubbing whore Jimmy wants to be. Funny enough, this song is only more relevant to today's music industry. And while this entire album is a masterclass of cynical satire, mocking their fans, the music industry, and society at large, it's the bitter yet infectious closing song that really encapsulates the entire thing. Mark David Chapman, named after the man who did the world a favor and finally shot John Lennon, relentlessly critiques the modern music industry, and particularly the, at the time, massive emo scene.
Distinguishable from one another. No possible intentions to even bother. It doesn't matter what is said or how we say it. Coincidentally, we all sound exactly the same. We all want to swindle kids out of their money. You're still doing this because you believe in it. It was somebody.
And if you thought that was a harsh take, just wait until you hear the second verse.
Dangling in our faces, making us all indescribably indistinguishable from each other. Or maybe I'm just another megalomaniac.
And, you know, I gotta say, he wasn't wrong. Mindless would see their peak success at this time and do many headlining tours across America and Europe for the following few years. And now, with many artists beginning to take influence from them, really showing how far the band had come, this would all lead up to a year-long hiatus in 2011, not offering up their fifth full-length album, but holding it hostage.
Do you want your new Mindless Self-Indulgence record?
Well, then you will have to pay us for it, motherfuckers!
Our new record, entitled... Our new record is right here in my fucking noodle. And if you ever want to hear it, you better click on the incentives on the side of the page.
How I Learned to Stop Giving a Shit and Love Mindless Self-Indulgence was the band's biggest record on launch as well as their last, at least for now. The album was first revealed in 2012 when the band released a video holding the album hostage, showing off a few snippets of songs, and Jimmy taunting the fans by claiming he was holding it hostage until enough people paid a ransom for it by pledging to a Kickstarter campaign. The Kickstarter was an overwhelming success, and in 2013, the album was released independently, only to later be picked up and distributed by Metropolis Records nonetheless, a legendary industrial and dark wave label, hosting bands such as Skinny Puppy, KMFDM, The Birthday Massacre, and now MSI themselves. Now, if I'm being honest, How I Learned to Stop Giving a Shit is my least favorite MSI album, And honestly, that might sound harsh, but the album sounds very watered down and overly polished for the band, as well as it came across as a bit phoned in lyrically, and at times even out of touch and kinda cringe. Jimmy shows off his boomer age, and due to the album more than likely being written during 2009 through 2011, the references and nods to internet and meme culture sound stale and kinda like your dad trying to sound hip and cool when he's talking to you and your friends. The best example of this is the song Anonymous. Yeah, gamers rise up, Anons. Bottom text. But beyond that, the album did have some good tracks on it, with clever and funny lyrics that we've come to expect from them. Songs that come to mind would be the classic MSI-sounding song, Witness, with absurd and braggadocious lyrics such as... Another great song on this album would be A La Mode, a kid-friendly little ditty about how great ice cream is. I like my girls like my women, and my women like my girls, with ice cream on their ass and my dick in their world. I ain't fucking around, I'm as serious as school teachers. I got 31 flavors to make. Yeah, simply beautiful. But this was Mindless Self-Indulgence's swan song. Outside of a compilation of demos and rarities of songs Jimmy had wrote throughout the early 90s named Pink, which was released in 2015, as well as some new merchandise here and there, this was kind of it for the band. They had gone on an indefinite hiatus in 2014. And while I think If would have been a fitting end to the band, I don't mind How I Learned, because it's a good reminder that no matter how counterculture and edgy you are, one day you'll be an out-of-touch boomer too. It also marked the end of Jimmy's 15-year run of being a beautifully cynical artist, and while many fans have awaited a return of MSI since they never officially split up, given the milquetoast reception of Jimmy's solo project, as well as his really odd embrace of social justice, as ass-backward as it sounds for someone like him, and the current lawsuit and allegations against Jimmy Urin, I think it's safe to say that Mindless Self-Indulgence is a thing of the past. But that being said, Mindless Self-Indulgence's discography is well worth your time, and the music they put out I think will stand the test of time. It's also a great capsule of countercultural angst and a testament to cynical satire, especially that of the Y2K era. But with all that being said, I hope you enjoyed the video. Support me on Patreon, subscribe, I'll see you in the next one.